Okay, hi guys. So this is presentation about JAX-RS 2.0 with Apache CXF. And for the most part, it will be about JAX-RS 2.0 and the new features which it introduces in the HTTP application development. And there'll be two slides about Apache CXF, really, like just a single slide introduction at the start of the presentation and the last slide at the end of the presentation about the TCK compliance. Okay, it's a reasonably short presentation. I'm hoping to keep it like in a relaxed mode, and I'll be intermixing the slides with the code examples, right? So some basic code examples. So they will be available on JIT. So hopefully there won't be any problems accessing it afterwards. Okay. So I work for Talent. So Talent has sponsored this trip for me, and I blog at this address, right? So we've had a lot about Apache CXF today, about Dan presented like a full-featured presentation, and Cole mentioned about CXF, and other people have mentioned about Apache CXF. So just a single slide kind of capturing what CXF is about, right? CXF ships production quality WS and RS services, and production quality means that they're used in production like by companies and by developers, depending on delivering some kind of service to the customers. So extremely well tested. I mean, and this is where the value of open source comes in. The source is extremely well tested, and we probably have like every line of the code like covered if we were to run coverage on this. So. The differentiator of Apache CXF, it ships common runtime, right? Common runtime, transports, interceptors, and features. So like the runtime makes sure that the requests are delivered to the endpoints. Transport makes sure that different type of messages delivered to the endpoints. Interceptors intercept the requests, and features, it's like a composite interceptors, right? So it runs basically everywhere in Servlet and OGI containers. And all sorts of Servlet containers have been tested to run Apache CXF. And SGI containers are optimized to run in Caraf container, and it will work with in Equinox and Felix and other containers. It supports all sorts of injection frameworks. It supports Blueprint in SGI. It's been optimized for a long time to work really well with Spring. And right now we have a CDI project in process to get it better integrated with CDI. So for example, we have top class containers like Tommy and JBoss, which do their own CDI work. And we ship like a simple model right now, CDI model, which will allow people to use it outside of those containers. So CXF 3.0, that's like the single line capturing the things which have been shipped, will be shipped, right? And Dan has talked a lot about it, and Colm talked about it. And basically, JAX-RS 2.0 application specification, and it's very important. It's been very important for us to ship it, to implement it, because users are keen to work with the latest and greatest specifications, and it's been like a high priority task. OS2, it's a major security effort which is undergoing right now, and we think that, and I think in particular that it's the most important security specification right now, because even despite the fact that it's had some bad press, but we could talk about it at length some other time. W security streaming, and this is, Colm did a lot of work about it, and it's, as Colm demonstrated in his talk, that the typical AWS security processing, which will be probably found in other SOAP stacks, is not efficient, and streaming just streamlines the processing. It's really cool, it's top level effort. WebSocket, that's the new transport has been introduced, right? So, and this will allow JAX-RS applications and SOAP applications to do WebSocket protocol. As far as JAX-RS is concerned, the movement is to support the thin client application using WebSocket, server-side events, so there'll be a movement around this in JAX-RS space. So the CXF is distinguished by the fact that it's really takes really serious security, interoperability, and compatibility, right? Security, we have the industry experts in our team, Colm, others people, and researchers from top universities who just report security bugs, and security features bugs are resolved immediately. And we'd like to think, as Dan said, that we ship the best security implementation into the web services space. And in fact, I was very pleased yesterday by watching the SSL, by listening to the SSL State of the Union presentation, and it was very entertaining presentation, and the guy basically listed, referred to the well-known article published by Stanford University and other scientists referring to various web services stacks which have had a known public key cryptography issue. And CXF comes up as an only implementation which has fixed it before the article even has been published, so it's very cool. Interoperability is like a top priority, of course, as well. And the next feature is compatibility, right? It means that basically in the typical production, after you've deployed your endpoint and you've now created a new interface, you'd like your old clients working, right? And or likewise, you deployed your new endpoints, but you still have so many endpoints around that you want your new clients working with the old endpoints. So we have quite neat support for handling this kind of transformations really neatly and in a lightweight fashion. So that's important, right? So we have interesting sub-projects. FIDIS SSO is a very high priority. Well, it's high priority, I would say. It's a new and very promising project, like, so we expect it to grow and become like a single sign-on center supporting different profiles, right? Right now it supports AWS passive profile, it will be supporting much more than that. Distributed SGI, and the one line which I would like to check upon is that philosophy of CXF is simple. Like, we've never had like strong religious discussions in our lists that you have to write this way or that way, otherwise you are like silly or something like that. You know, I've seen during the years many like discussions where people were ready to kill each other, you know, like arguing that you have to do REST or you have to do AWS or you have to do it this way or the other way. And in the end of the day, the most important factor is what works for the client, right? So if the client developer is able to deliver for the client using AWS stack, that's what is most important for that client, for that developer. Likewise, for the rest. So, and that's why CXF over the years have like come up on top as like a platform which offers a fairly unique environment for people to write web services, SOAP web services, REST web services, using common features. And many users choose it today because of specifically this integration, right? Because we have very cool integration about supporting different styles at the same time, if needed, right? It's a complete web services platform, and I say it's a complete web services platform. I say it's like a Spring of web services, if you know what I mean. Because if you're a Spring fan, you know that you can do everything in Spring. You can write web services in Spring. You can write using Spring AWS or whatever. You can do everything in Spring. And I think we are getting with CXF at the level where we can do, as far as your web services requirements are concerned, starting from security, like different sort of processing, injection of the application resources into your endpoints bins, we cover it at all at CXF level. So, okay, now. So that's, I'll do a short introduction to JAX-RS, a brief history of it, right? And it's the single line, seven client HTTP services made easy. It's it streamlines HTTP service development, right? For example, Servlet API has been around for years, and we all know that we can write a servlet which and check if it's GET, do this, and if it's POST, do that. And if you'd like to do asynchronous processing, then you like do such a sophisticated code, and specifically remembering the David's line today from his Tom Yee presentation is that you need to check few blocks and a few expert articles showing how to do, for example, asynchronous processing, like servlet-based asynchronous processing. So anyway, so that's what it's about. It's great for REST and HTTP application in general. And it's an important characterization because many so-called, many people say it's a REST endpoint. At the end of the day, it's a very plain, simple HTTP application. And JAX-RS lets you do, let you scale. So it lets you write a simple application, or you can do, let you do something very sophisticated, something like what Paul talked about. Right? And so in one, JAX-RS 1.0 was released in, trying to keep an eye on the watch. So 1.0 was released in October 2008, and Paul Sanders and Mark Hodley were leading this effort. They really re-energized the HTTP development space at the time, and they were very, very popular and developers who, and spec leads who really, really kind of did a breakthrough, so to say, and with this approach, okay. And JAX-RS 1.1 was released in November 2009. Jersey is a well-known reference implementation. It's a top-class reference implementation. REST Easy is shipped by Red Hat, JBoss, and Bill Berg is the lead. And at the time, also Dan mentioned that in his talk, that CXF at the time was already a second to none SOAP spec implementation. And that said, we thought that it's really important to support different styles of building web services for CXF, not to eventually become an end of line, in 5-10 years kind of project. So we didn't want CXF to kind of to become Corba-like stack, whereby we all know that Corba works today, but it's no one talks about it. So we really wanted to support different styles. And we went through quite a few hurdles to convince people around us to make it happen. Okay, then other projects like Apache Clearyza, Apache Wing, others started adopting JAX-RS. So next, Oracle acquired Sun, and Paul and Mark leave, and there was a sense of deja vu in the community thinking what's going to happen next now that such popular people have left. And fortunately enough, a few years later, Marek and Santiago came on board, and I had a chance to work with these people, and they've been absolute stars, Marek specifically. So JAX-RS 2.0 was released in May 2013. Planning is on the way for 2.1, 3.0 will follow, and it will focus on model view controller support, proper model view controller support, proper support for web single server-side events and stuff like that. So it's a very active, and it's a very one of the most popular GSP specifications around. So JAX-RS 2.0, just next slide will be about JAX-RS 2.0. So that's JAX-RS 2.0 introduction, right? So that you could see what's new in JAX-RS 2.0 easier. So in JAX-RS 1.0, typical concepts are you introduce root resources, right? And every class, a single class represents typically a root resource, right? So and in CXF, for example, we can have single endpoints handling multiple routes, right? And we can have many endpoints using multiple routes with different URI spaces. So we have a very flexible stuff around it in CXF. Further, when you want to, for example, when your root resource implementation becomes sophisticated, you can delegate it to something called sub-resource, right? So it's sub-resource, just another instance, and I'll show it in a sec, basically allowing it to delegate the processing to help us, like kind of. And also, it also allows you to introduce the dynamism of the processing. Annotation markers as methods. URI headers and payloads captured as method parameters. Message, the actual data handled by registered body providers, right? And body providers, they basically handle reads and writes. So they, for example, given a book class, they will read it into XML or JSON or text or whatever you need. Atom, doesn't matter. And injected context helps with the request processing. So for example, you can have a resource injected with something called URI info, which will tell you all the information about the current request, okay? So like request URI, which headers are there, stuff like that, security context, and so on. Response can be returned as the, your typical application bin, which will be handled by the message body provider. Or it can be returned as something called JAX arrest response, wrapped into containing bin and additional headers. JAX arrest features are very, very good for conditional HTTP request. Conditional HTTP request processing is actually very subtle to do right. It's very sophisticated. It's quite complex. And even if you read the latest HTTP specs, where it's all written quite clearly, it's still like a pretty major piece of text. And to do it right, you need to be a sophisticated HTTP developer. And it's not enough to get it streamlined, getting into mainstream, right? So JAX arrest does it really, really neatly. Okay. I'll just show you a quick example now. So that's a typical JAX arrest resource, right? So it starts with the path, okay? And then this is something that the runtime will inject, and that provides information about the request, right? Then you introduce as many methods as you want and supporting different flows, right? Different HTTP verbs. So for example, in this example, we have a method supporting a GET request, right? And it will support a request like this, you know? So for example, the template parameter can capture different values, okay? And produces value will contain application XML or XML JSON or both, and so on. So the providers will handle serialization of the book class, okay? And that's a basic method. The slightly more sophisticated method where you can also introduce query parameters into the picture. And you can default, so for a query parameter is an optional parameter, therefore it's not guaranteed to be there. But to ensure simple processing, you don't want to check if it's null, then do this, if it's not null, do that, so you just introduce default value, and so for example, if it's the customer, the client hasn't set the value, it would be defaulted to something. Okay. What is it? So that's just return, shows the different path variation and different format. That shows how you can like add a kind of book the pure REST way. So you submit kind of some name, the server creates a resource. New book. It puts this new book into the local whatever storage database or memory base, doesn't matter. And it uses the injected URI info context. It's a pretty cool pattern as well to get the current request and then URI, and then it builds the link to the newly created resource, right? Using this pattern, and then it just returns response. And at the HTTP level, it would be something like 201. HTTP header location pointing to new resource. And the resource method which you have seen like above, they will handle the request for this new resource. So it's pretty neat. So like, and then you would like to thinking that this root resource has become a bit too sophisticated, you move it to the into sub-resource. So like sub-resource is different from regular resource method that it only has a path annotation. So the runtime will match the sub-resource, and then it will continue looking for the actual method which can handle the request. So it will sub-resource in this example is basic, so it supports the form will update using application form encoded. Okay. Now the root resource 2 is a bit more interesting. It basically shows the just basic implementation, conditional implementation, right? Conditional HTTP. And as I said, it can be like, I mean, it's quite neat, I think. So like manually, it's quite tricky to write, right? To do it correctly. So what you do is just like, so assuming your customer asking for the request, get me the book by given ID, right? So what we check, do you have an entity tag for this ID? If you don't, then we're just creating a response, right? And then we calculate tag, which is in our case a weak e tag, and we keep it in the map and respond, return the response. And the response will contain the book instance, right, and the e tag. So like at HTTP level, you will see whatever e tag, right? So for example, so next time the client comes in, some other client, and give me the book by that ID. So suppose we now have the e tag. So what we do, all we do, we just basically using an request context which has been injected above, right? And we just do evaluate the preconditions, and the runtime will make it right to ensure that if the tag which client provided matches the one we know about, then it means that the local resource has not been updated. So we just, if it's not been, if it's been updated, then its resource response builder will be equal to null. So if the resource has been updated, we do it again and return the new book. Otherwise, we just, that's as complex as it can become. And in conditional HTTP, there could be other variables like if, non-modified since, or if modified from, and it's just like, it's really, I think it's sophisticated enough, right? So, and I think it's a very, very neat pattern which Paul introduced in his initial effort. Okay, so, now, okay, I'll just move on to other, the few other, the code is available online, so just I won't spend more time on this right now. Okay, so this is just a summary of typical JaxRS API attempts, right? So we have path, different HTTP web methods, have path parameter, query parameter, header parameter, produces and consumes controls, content negotiation process, so we can, depending on what client has requested, it can affect the method resource selection. Different utilities for, for managing complex HTTP entities, headers. Different security, different context, right? Which can security context, HTTP headers, URI info, which can let you know all you need to know about the current request. And message body writer, reader, and so on, so, and providers, which can control the actual serialization process. So finally, we are moving to 2.0. Yeah, and I will just try to be a bit faster. So what's new in JaxRS 2.0? Okay, so client API has been introduced, right? The client API is a very well designed API, and it supports synchronous, asynchronous invocations, and it supports fluent style, meaning that you can build a complex sequence using a single line, right? Single code line effectively, right? And it supports typed, untyped serialization. So it's a top class support for clients do simple or sophisticated interactions with the endpoints. Asynchronous server, again, top class support for asynchronous servers, right? So, and I'll show the example later on. And I think it's difficult to do it right if you do it at the servlet level. I mean, and the experience shows and the number of bugs people report that like different servlet 3 implementations treat API slightly differently. Like, so I mean, so CXF will ensure that it just works, whether it's Jetty, Tomcat, or something else. Like, I mean, and on top of that, the very neat and simple API makes it kind of straightforward for people to start experimenting with asynchronous servers, right? We don't have to be a socket expert or something like that just to start doing it. So filters, it's been missing in 1.0. Filters can be bound globally or on a method-specific filter statically and dynamically. So it can be, they can be bound globally, which apply to all methods or to individual method, and this can be done statically or dynamically. Beta exception hierarchy, injection support for sub-resources, beta support for converting parameters, where you have, for example, existing application class, and your method parameter says book, well, the client submits a value like one. So we need the runtime will provide the mechanism for converting one into the book, right? Okay, with the set of registered providers and other things. Okay, this is a summary of typical T0 API attempts, and I will just move on to the example just to show. We will show the examples soon. So a client builder, client and web digits supports you, let you do client API. Request and response filters on the client side control the pre and post-processed request. The same on the server side, container request filters. Write interceptors and read interceptors, these are kind of, they act like filters, and I think they may be a tiny bit redundant, but they just let you kind of control the serialization process more neatly, kind of interpose and control the serialization process. So name binding and priority, these are the features which are used to bind specific interceptors to specific methods, and priority control their priority, right? Very sophisticated support for features, configuration, and dynamic feature is probably the best one of them because it's the simplest. So, link builder, parameter converter provider, and async response. So now we're moving to the next slide, and I'll show you the examples. Now, client API, so that's the main, the first big feature. It was absent, the standard API was absent in JAX-RS 1.0, and each implementing stack was implementing it their own way. And it's a typical sequence. Client builder creates a client. Client creates web target. And then the target creates invoker. And I think there's maybe one too many entities in this sequence. So ideally, it would be just three sequences. But that's how it is right now. So you can do synchronous, asynchronous invocations. Response, which have been introduced in JAX-RS 1.0, can be reused on the client side to do typed reads. Pretty cool. Filters, you can do SSL properties right on the API. Very sophisticated configuration and features support, and I can't say I understand all of it right now because it's a bit too complex to my liking, but it's good that something is there anyway. And so the core example, so that would be the client API. Examples, so that's the basic client API sequence, right? So you have an address, right? You have create a client. The client is just kind of the, just the client. Representation of the thing which will call on the entity. And then from that you create web target. And then you decide what you want to do, whether you want to do the synchronous invocation or asynchronous invocation. You do asynchronous invocation and which will do, for example, application JSON get request. And then you just do invoker get. And that's it. So this line is very neat. I mean, this book, HTTP payload has been neatly transformed into your custom application class. Okay. So thanks to this provider model, whereby you could register everything you need to do. CXF? Not actually. It's still been used quite a lot, and this new API is implemented in terms of the existing so-called legacy client API. I think that it's my own opinion. I think that this API and the API we implement. Slightly different. No, I think it's more kind of more procedural, and I think the CXF API has been modeled kind of to model the typical browsing experience of the user, okay, in the browser, which is kind of slightly different. But probably it will be deprecated eventually, but not right now. People are still using it a lot. Slightly different variation of the same request, but using the Fluent style, right? So we just link everything together. You read your entity. This is like a typed read on the response, yeah. And then you could continue checking your response using response get status and so on. Okay. So this is an example of the asynchronous invocation. So you create an entity, well, like you want to post something, and it doesn't have to be a post, but just an example of showing post. So create a JSON entity, then you create a synchronous invoke, and then you do your typical future-based processing. So you just posted something, and then you just check your future, right? And that shows also how like the all sort of HTTP errors have been neatly transformed into exceptions. So for example, in JAX-RS 1.0, you would catch, for example, web application exception and start checking status manually. If it's, for example, 4.0, do this. If it's 4.0.1, do that. And this is now just more typed, better support, right? A similar example using invocation callback. So that's it, okay, as far as this example is concerned. And server filters, this is a big thing as well in JAX-RS 2.0, and you could register in-out filters, interceptors, and they just can do anything you need to do about pre and post-processing the request. They just do anything you would expect filters to do. And it just can do anything, like, and they can affect the matching algorithm. So for example, if you have whatever, some old client thinking that it invokes on this URI, but your endpoint has changed somehow, like address, that filters can handle that and can ensure the old client will be matched properly to the new endpoint. And they can affect like headers, just everything. So I'll show a quick example. And they're so rich, it doesn't make, we can talk about filters like for 45 minutes alone. So just, what is it? It's like a simple filter implementation which implements both in and out filters, right? So it just does something. I just invented, you know, like you just check security context. If it's not an authenticated request, just abort the request. So no, you have to sign in. Okay. Then we just whatever check the method, and if it's post or put, then we filter the request somehow. I haven't implemented a specific filter implementation, but we just do it. Okay, so it's very rich API, and on the response on the way back, that would be the container response filter implementation. We just check if it's book, then update the actual name in addition to what the application said. So for example, suppose we have application code which cannot be changed, right? So we have the filter, but the client expects the different name, right? So we have a response filter which will set the name properly. Okay, and finally, so for example, it has something like called name binding annotation, which has been introduced in 2.0. And this filter is annotated with this annotation. And runtime will match this filter only to those resource methods which have the same annotation. So it allows you to do per method specific bindings. Okay, the same will work on the client API side, on the server side, and things like that. So what is L to do? Just a quick example of the pre-matching filter. That's the filter which I showed just right now. It was after the runtime has found the method which will be invoked, it will apply those filters. There's a notion of pre-matching filter which can affect the matching algorithm before the method has been selected. Okay, so what do we have next? I guess there are many things to talk about, but I would just focus. Yeah, I'll have probably I'll focus on this one, and then I'll just start concluding. And I think it's the best feature of JAX-RS 2.0, as far as I'm concerned. I like it a lot, and I'd like to give credit to the spec lead, Marek, who's done an enormous amount of like evaluation of different approaches. Like, I mean, just so many approaches, and he just like did a huge analysis of it, and he just like made a very neat, simple to use and very flexible API. So it invites itself to, it asks users, just try me. Like, I mean, it's really, really powerful. And at the same time, it's really, really easy to use. And so it's something top API needs something like that for it to be used. When it becomes a bit too sophisticated, like sophisticated users will do it, users who may be confused about it won't do it, and the API will fail eventually. So that what it can do. I'll just show you the example, okay? And asynchronous API, where is it? That's very simple, implementation. So, like, we'd like to request a book, right, by this ID, but we know that our client doesn't know it's a synchronous request. But in our implementation, we know that it will take quite a few seconds to actually to get this book from somewhere else. Maybe we'll need to web crawl it and using Nudge and inject it into database. And then retrieve it from there. So, basically, we check, is it available in our local map storage? It's not available. We just suspend this request in our local map. It's just one pattern. There are two patterns in this code example. But this is the first pattern. It's a simple pattern, right? So we just, book is not there. We suspend our request, right? And then someone comes in, and some other client comes in and posts this book. Just like creates a book with the ID, which some other client is waiting upon for. So what we do, we just create this book, right? We remove our pending request using this ID. And we basically say, resume suspended request, and the client will actually get his book, right? And the way we resume it, it's like this. So we just resume, and this is your book, right? So the runtime will just take it, this book will serialize it to the pending client, or clients, or many clients waiting for this book, and it just works. We have the kind of the pattern where multiple parties cooperate with each other. The other pattern is really cool, and again, I would like to highlight it's really neat. I think it will be very difficult to beat this API in terms of its simplicity and flexibility. So we'd like to get a book, right? Okay, and again, we know it will take a while to get the book from somewhere else. So we create something called timeout handler, right? We just pass it ID of the requested book, and we register this timeout handler with our asynchronous implementation and suspend the request for 2 seconds. Okay, and from then on, this timeout handler will manage the process. So for example, if by the time after the 2 seconds have expired, the book is not available, then is it 10 minutes? Okay, yeah, I'm close here enough. So I thought it was 10, you know. Anyway, so we register this handler, and then the handler will decide what to do next after 2 seconds. If the book will be available, and I'll show it later. And it will return the response, or it will manage to keep the synchronous the request pending. And it's very cool. So we just pass this handler to some kind of cool method, which will implement it, start a worker thread, and just will start the some process which will get your book from some storage and assemble it from different pieces. I don't know. It's a slow process, right? So now what happens now is that we just have that's our basic implementation. I think it's quite functional, actually, and for the real user, to be honest, because it's really flexible. And so you have this handler. So after 2 seconds have passed, the runtime will call this handle timeout method, right? So we check, do we have the book now available in our storage? If it's not available, then, that's a bit confusing, actually. So the not available is a specific flag which this function will set if it's known that result is just not there. It won't be there at all, right? So if it's not available, so we've done some long process work, we check, we know it won't be there. So we just say it's not available. So we just say not found exception. A typical response, 404, okay? Now, if you're still, the process is still ongoing, so, and we haven't waited for too long, so for example, 10 seconds, a reasonable time we think, okay? Then we just basically set timeout tell the runtime, wait for another 2 seconds, we continue working, right? Okay? Otherwise, if you really waited for too long, so in this line we said, set timeout, and that's it, and the same process will repeat next in 2 seconds. So handle timeout will be called yet again in 2 seconds, and then we'll decide again what to do. However, if you really waited for longer than 10 seconds, we just basically cancel, which will be 503 HTTP status code. And in this case, we also say retry in 10 seconds. So, I mean, it's these two patterns will let you do, I think, just pretty much anything you need to do. And with async server processing. And on top of that, you just CXF ensures the kind of the portability of it, so that will work across different containers. It's my favorite JAX-REST terminal features. Okay, so I guess, so what else do we have? So suspend request. I'll just touch quickly on miscellaneous features. Better exception hierarchy, we've seen it. New context, resource info context. It can let you know in your filter or implementation class, better more in the filter, what class you're dealing with. Resource context injection, it's kind of, it wasn't possible to inject into sub-resources context information before. Link header builder, matching across multiple routes with the same path wasn't supported well in 1.0. Conversion support, capturing request parameter and context into bins, quick examples of that. Something like, the typical and the classical JAX-REST will list all those parameters, the method parameters. Okay, so you have, and if you have 10 parameters or whatever, it can become quite long. And this bin, it just captures everything in itself. So you just, in your method parameter, we just have instance of this bin parameter info. Kind of lets you have compact method signatures. Okay. That's pretty much it. And I'd like to touch on my JAX-REST favorites. I think JAX-REST 1.0 is the request context, which lets you handle this kind of request preconditioning. And I think it's a real gem because not many people actually using it, maybe not aware of it, because of the actual complexity associated with HTTP conditional, and maybe been scared of not doing it right and such and so on. But it's a real gem because it makes it possible to do it right and the easy way. Okay, and asynchronous suspended invocation is a top design. I think the spec lead has done a really, really top job here. Okay. Finally, a slide on JAX-REST compliance, and I had to introduce this just before the Apache Con, just to, there was some concerns in the certain circles that maybe in the Oracle world, if your implementation doesn't pass 2,000 tests associated with the TCK, you're kind of a failure. And it actually is important for some clients because you can imagine governments or whatever, they're just like ticks. You have to have a TCK compliance. You don't have a TCK compliance, it's a consent, yeah? Thanks. And so we were asked gently, after not very gentle discussion, that it's better that CXF makes it obvious that we do not have a final TCK compliance stack. We really, I think, in my own opinion, we failed. We passed the early TCK test with few exceptions, which we have challenged, and I think it's technically complete, though it's possible some edge cases are not covered. And we encourage people to report any bugs issued. So the conclusion of that, to this saga, that the fact that Oracle doesn't provide TCK to Apache is a problem. Because it can affect the project working with TCK, GCP specification may lose in the end of the day. And I think it's, and the project has to be healthy. For the project to be healthy, it needs to have as many users as possible. So that's pretty much it. This is a few links, and I've uploaded my presentation. It's all available online. So JAX-RS link. That's where the these examples. I haven't touched on them as much as I wanted to. So you can browse this URI and check like some concept. That's it. Yeah. Any questions, please? I think it still works thread local way. Like when we suspend the request, we tell the underlying container just return your thread, and actually no, we associate the current depending CXF exchange, right? So like local internal object. With internal storage, right? So when the and I can touch on it later on, but basically we have the Celia 3 API wrappers, which will associate the resumed request with the pending storage. So we kind of ensure that whatever storage we have pending, right, it's associated with the new, even if it would be a different thread. So, and when the thread is suspended, we just like save it somewhere else. Yeah, we can definitely touch on that later on. Okay. So, cool. Okay. Thanks. Cheers. Thanks.